folks. Welcome to another Triple T Thursday. For those just joining us, that's Tools, Tips, and Talk, where we'll discuss info for the knife maker. In today's episode, I'm going to do an overview of the press. I always have a lot of people ask me about the press. It is homemade. It's something I made. And how did I do it? How did I build it? So take a look. There'll be a parts list down in the description, so go check that out. Let's go over it, and I'll tell you all about it. So let's talk about the press. This is what's called an H-frame. It's one of the most solid press designs just because of the vertical beams and then the crosses. It's not like the C style where you get a little more flex. So this one's really solid. Let's talk about the construction. So this is I-beam, so it's all solid I-beam. It's 5-inch by 8-inch I-beam. Okay, I think this is quarter inch, I think. Could be 3/8, probably 3/8. And it's 5 foot tall. So put this in frame. 5 foot tall, top to bottom. I went to the steel yard and I purchased those I-beams. I got them to cut them to length. I also got them to cut a 12-inch piece here and a 12-inch piece for here and a 12-inch piece for the head. So that was basically the construction. Then it was as simple as just welding up the seams here and here. I also put a bunch of, so this is the I-beam this way. Sorry, the I-beam this way. And then I also put some more angle iron inside the I-beam just to make sure that there was no flex. It was probably overkill. Then, of course, on the bottom as well, down here, it's welded the same. So let's talk about the cylinder. So this is a 30-ton cylinder. It is 5 inches in diameter. And it's the kind that has the cylinder clevis at both ends, so there's a pin on both ends. And this is a 1.5-inch pin. So this is... I didn't have 1-inch plate, so I had 2 half-inch plates here that I just welded together after using just a regular hole saw. And I drilled all of these separately, and then I welded them all up and welded them to the head. I did a similar thing at the bottom, but I made this whole carriage removable so that I could get the cylinder out, because you can't actually replace the pin here. It probably would have been smarter to rotate this so the pin went this way. But yeah, I just didn't want it sticking out, but that probably would have been a better idea. The other thing you'll notice about this press is with the cylinder on the bottom, the press presses up. A lot of people think that they need the cylinder on the top so that it presses down. Okay, it doesn't matter. And it's much easier to have what you're going to work on at almost at eye level, because you're going to want to see it. When it's down here, you can't see it and you're always crouching over to look at it. So I prefer it up here. It's not eye level for me because I'm 6'2", but it's not far off. Okay, this is at least 4 foot high here. So it's pretty close. So I much prefer having the cylinder on the bottom. And then the whole thing is only about 5 feet tall. It's 5.5 feet tall because it's got casters on it. So let's talk a bit more about the head. So you can see that with the I-beam here, I just put the head here, which again is a piece of I-beam flipped on its side, and then I welded plates on either side. Again, after putting those angle irons inside, like inside the empty parts of the I-beam, just to give it more rigidity. Then I bought some 2x3-inch angle, just drilled and tapped the holes so that I could clamp this on all four sides around the I-beam. So it's not going anywhere. And then I just rounded the corners of this I-beam here and here, just kind of put a radius on them so that it matched the radius of the inside of the angle. And it moves up and down really nicely. There's some grease on it. And I put these angles in here just so that, you know, things didn't fall into this. I didn't get any slag or scale falling into the edges there.
So let's talk about the die holder. So the die holder is really simply, take this out, just, you can see just two pieces of half inch, just stacked, staircased on top of each other. All of my die holders are half inch plate, and they are square. They are 4-inch square. And the reason they're square is because then I can put every die in either this way, or I can flip it on its side that way. Same with the top. That's very convenient because my rounding dies, my drawing dies, I can flip on the side and I can use them to draw the other way. So really good feature. And then I just installed these little gravity holder here so the dies don't come out, and this one just lifts up. So let's look at the dies that I made. And these are all mild steel. Okay, you don't need hardened steel dies for a press. I've never had them worn out, and I've used this press for going on 3 years now. So I have flat dies. Okay, there's a bit of a radius on here. Okay, I do a lot of work, obviously, with the flat dies. The other ones I use the most are my drawing dies. And you can see they're not perfectly round. There's a little dish to them, but these are great for drawing out without being really aggressive. Okay, I do have really aggressive rounding dies, but this can get away from you really quickly, and you can actually put some really deep valleys in steel with these. So you need to use these very carefully. Brian House had the same problem on his, so he's going to make, I know, some of those less aggressive ones. Also, I've got some squaring dies that are great for doing canisters or just squaring up stock. And this is just made from 3/8 angle stacked together. So those are really good, really nice to have those. When I'm using the flat dies, I also created a bunch of kiss blocks. And these just have little brackets. They just sit on top here so you can press down, and then I don't have to worry about these falling off and stuff like that. So the kiss blocks are really handy, and I've got different sizes that I can just slide in there. So let's talk about the other parts that make the press work. The first thing is the valve. Okay, so the valve is going to control the direction of the oil and where the hydraulic oil is going. And that's what makes these cylinders move. You're pumping oil either into the top of the cylinder, the top of the cylinder, lowering the cylinder, or the bottom of the cylinder, raising the piston. So you want a valve that has a neutral. So it sits kind of in the center, okay? And if you're not touching it, it stops. Okay, it stops the movement of the piston. The log splitter ones are terrible because as soon as you let go, it has a spring and it returns. Okay, that's terrible for forging. You want it to stay where, as soon as you let go, you want it to stay where it is. So in this one, when it's down, it's retracting the cylinder. When it goes up, it's extending the cylinder and squishing. Okay, let's spin it around and we'll take a look at the back. That's why it's nice to have it on casters. So there's the back of the head, and you'll notice that there's a tray here. And that's really just so that the scale, when it comes out, will actually hit the tray and slide down, and it doesn't land on all of the hydraulics. So that was just a safety feature. So here's the main part. This is a 5-horsepower motor. The most important thing on a press like this is the speed. Okay, the speed that the head moves. What makes it move fast is a faster motor. So you want a really strong motor like a 5-horse. Okay, the motor is going to drive a pump. This is, I think, a 35-gallon-per-minute pump. There's links to all this down in the description. There's this coupler here. The pump will push the hydraulic oil either through the valve, and the valve will control whether it's going to the cylinder or it's just cycling back to the reservoir.
Okay. Obviously, the pump is going to pull oil from the reservoir down here. That is a 10-gallon reservoir. Okay. And I also put a pressure gauge and an oil filter, both of which probably weren't necessary, but I decided to have them put on anyway. The only thing I didn't do on this build is hook up the hydraulics. I had a guy come and do all that for me, so that it was done right, because I've never done hydraulics before. So I think it cost me $400 to get all of it, including the oil that he put in it. So I thought it was a decent deal. All in, this whole thing probably cost me between $1,200 and $1,400. Again, it's a 30-ton press. It is very, very strong, and it does everything you need as far as Damascus. It's very fast, and I'll show you guys, but the head on this thing will move probably about an inch and a half, close to 2 inches a second. So it's very fast, which is what you want. So if you've watched pretty much any of my videos, you've seen this thing in action. What I'm going to do is turn it on without speeding it up and without toning down the sound. So you're going to hear it full volume. So this is what it's like. So the pump on this one also has two modes to it. If you just put it down a little bit, it will make the cylinder move slowly. And if you're more than a quarter, it'll move at full speed. I was moving at full speed there. So there it is, folks. All the dies, I put these die holders in here, so it was easy to change the dies and didn't have to bend over. If there's any other questions you guys have about the press, put them down in the comments. Remember, folks, there's links to all of the parts down in the video description. So if you want to go build it yourself, go check those out. It's really simple to build. If you know how to weld and you know how to drill and tap holes, that's pretty much all you need to do. So give it a try. It will be a game changer for your forging, especially making Damascus. You really can't do complex Damascus patterns without a hydraulic press. Thanks for watching, folks. We'll see you on the next one.